The Great Indian Political Weekly.
Hello and welcome to this edition of the Great Indian Political Weekly, covering important developments in the Indian political, cultural and social landscape. I am Sandeep Balakrishna.
I am Hari Ravi Kumar.
So the topic for today's episode is Something Squalid for God, examining the cult of Mother Teresa and her missionaries of charity. First, let's begin by reading out a news report from the Times of India dated July 6th, 2018. According to the Times of India report, Sister Concilia, a nun at Missionaries of Charity's Nirmal Hriday home, was arrested in Ranchi for allegedly selling a child of an unwed mother. The Missionaries of Charity was set up by Nobel laureate Mother Teresa. Ranchi Superintendent of Police Anish Gupta said, two arrests have been made. A worker at the home was arrested on Wednesday. We have also got the details of three children who were sold by them to different couples. We are in the process of verifying their addresses. Nirmal Hriday at Ranchi's Jail Road offers shelter for unwed minor mothers and differently abled people. The home had 11 pregnant girls and around 75 differently abled persons living there. Sister Concilia was the head of the unwed mothers section. CWC member Tanushree Sarkar said, we have moved the 11 girls to Karuna shelter home and sealed that section of Nirmal Hriday. Sarkar also said, after the incident in one branch, we cannot trust the other branches of Missionaries of Charity and we will not be sending children to them for shelter from now on. Sarkar said of the 11 pregnant girls at the home, at least three were never produced at CWC. As per the law, any minor child in need of care and protection should first be produced before the committee. Together with this report, nuns have confessed on open camera to various journalists of different media outlets of a scheme which we can call buy three, get one free. That means you buy three infants and Nirmal Hriday or Missionaries of Charity will give one infant free. This is a nun confessing on open camera without heed for any consequences or whatever message that would send out to the society and the nation at large. Hari, what do you make of this?
I think one of the things that in our societies we are very scared to talk about is about saints. The moment somebody is made a saint and put on a pedestal, somehow we are not allowed to critically examine them. Now take the case of Gandhi. Nobody is allowed to say anything about Gandhi or even Nehru or Periyar. And one more in this long list is one-time obscure Albanian nun who was made famous by a BBC documentary, popularly known as Mother Teresa. And she became a pop icon to the extent that there is even a Rajnikant joke which says, you know, there was a girl who was making noise in school and Rajnikant said, keep quiet, and then later she grows up to become Mother Teresa. So to the extent that from a saint to a pop icon, she's all these things. But we have seen in history that the media machinations have tried so many times to make sinners into saints. And the enduring legacy of Hell's Angel continues even after her death. That's what is very evident from the news report that you just read out. Now, I would like to ask you what this means when we are talking about such a respected institution in the minds of the Indian people, the Missionaries of Charity. It evokes, you know, especially that blue and white sari evokes a certain kind of, you know, karuna rasa almost in the minds of people. But what bhayanaka rasa is behind that how this is being played out by the media, would you like to comment on that?
Well, there are a couple of threads on this, Karuna Rasa, etc. But what I would like to kind of clarify is that the institution by itself is not respected as much as the person who built it, for want of a better word.
Mm-hmm.
That is the so-called Mother Teresa. Each time you need to refer to her as Mother, make sure that you include that in bold and quotes. She was a mother for none, as we shall see. And she is the one who set up this Missionaries of Charity first in the slums of Kolkata, and also known as Nirmal Hriday or Pure Heart.
Now, there are so many people who come to India who have come on evangelical missions right from the, you know, British period and even before that. And especially in the post-colonial period, we have a lot of people who have come from, highly funded by foreign churches, come to India. Why did this obscure Albanian nun, whose name we find it difficult to pronounce, become so famous?
Well, for that you need to go back to the 50s actually, for some history. At that time, Malcolm Muggeridge, a lot of people have forgotten this name, but then he was a world famous journalist for BBC. He was the guy who actually first kind of discovered her, for want of a better word again, and then he launched her and he popularized her on the global scale, to the extent that Mother Teresa became a cult. She's no saint, as we shall see, but he popularized a cult when he visited her Missionaries of Charity home, ostensibly to do a documentary for the BBC. And then he wrote a spurious pamphlet called Something Beautiful for God, which was also the title of his BBC documentary. And perhaps the cult of Mother Teresa, or rather Mother Teresa, her Missionaries of Charity, Nirmal Hriday, wouldn't have been a cult but for this one man.
And now also, Sandeep, tell us a little bit about the pioneering work that has been done by people like Christopher Hitchens in bringing to light the lies and deceit and fraud of Teresa.
Well, actually, almost 95% or at the any rate more than 75% of credit for exposing this fraud named Mother Teresa should squarely go to Christopher Hitchens. When he said, I mean, his missionaries, his book, The Missionary Position, is a classic in its own right, and it is actually an extremely good case study for how to write an iconoclastic and well-researched and a book that uses reason and logic to dispel myths. It is a cult classic in many ways, dispelling the myth of a cult called Mother Teresa. So when Malcolm Muggeridge and his gang started making all these extraordinary claims, Christopher Hitchens asked one simple question. Why is that the kind of claims that they made? And there is a little bit of a backstory to Muggeridge also. Malcolm Muggeridge took his camera crew, his documentary crew, to obviously shoot the film, the documentary there. And at that time, his photographer was using, I think, a new innovation developed by in film developed by Kodak. And when he shot that, in the process of making the documentary, when this photographer shot some pictures inside the building of Missionaries of Charity, there he found that the exposure and there's a beautiful light, and he exclaimed that, you know, this is extremely good quality film, that this is a great innovation that Kodak has done, and that, you know, we must, going forward, we must use this. Immediately, Malcolm Muggeridge, in the words of Christopher Hitchens, that old fraud and mountebank, Malcolm Muggeridge told him, shut up, this is no innovation by Kodak, but it's actually divine light. That was enough. And this is the starting point of sorts that Hitchens took before he began to systematically, clinically demolish, inquire and demolish the myth of Mother Teresa. So that's a long story, cutting it short.
And there's also a lot of evidence after Hitchens' work, which I think came out in 1995. There's a lot of other evidence against the Missionaries of Charity. So, Sandeep, tell us a little bit about the kind of scary stories out of Nirmal Hriday.
Well, for one thing, we can do this in two different ways, but we'll do this in reverse chronology. It is now very well known that Missionaries of Charity happens to be the largest donor to the Vatican bank controlled entirely by the Pope, or rather the Vatican Church, right? So how did this kind of money, and it has Missionaries of Charity has missions and whatever, nunneries and cloisters in about more than 150 countries in the world. So all this kind of money has never been audited. It has never been audited so far.
Never been taxed.
Never been taxed. So from this, when we, you know, kind of do a flashback, for all her claims of serving the poor and the destitute and the sick and the dying and the near dying, for all that, this kind of wealth, she could have built a hospital in every city in India.
But she didn't. And in fact, you know, when I was preparing for this discussion with you, one thing that struck me was when you see the name Missionaries of Charity, it's so cleverly constructed, because missionaries suggest Christian missionaries. So the people who are getting the benefits should be reinforced with the fact that this is Christianity helping them, which will eventually help them convert or change their mind. And charity is a very nice word for fundraising. So you can go to all the corporates and other people with fat you know, wallets and ask for money. So you get a lot of money and you build your brand so that you can easily convert people down the line. So clearly, I think if you look at the name itself, there is so much of hidden agenda in it.
Oh, there's nothing hidden there. I mean, the moment you use the word missionary, it is damn clear. It is damn clear. That is the reason that Hitchens has titled this book beautifully, The Missionary Position. It's a pun at multiple levels. It's called a missionary position in a sexual way. It is called a missionary position because of everything that this nun of the Vatican mission, or whatever
the Catholic Church,
mission of the Catholic Church stands for.
Absolutely.
Absolute Christian, Catholic Christian fundamentalism.
And I think in a sense, let's just go back a little now to how this developed in India with the British colonial imperialist system, the East India Company and the takeover by the British government. All through, they were supporting evangelical activities. All through, they were supporting activities of proselytization and conversion. And even today, the lands that the church owns in India is all gifts of the British government.
No, absolutely. So, colonialism and evangelism was one of the key organs of British colonial policy in India. So, on our part, the native Indians, Hindus, whatever you want to call them, the moment we got freedom in 47, the first thing we should have done is to have nationalized all the church lands. And I make no apologies or no bones about this, because all that land, imagine this, Hari, if I tell you, and I'm sure you know this, that the Catholic Church, or whatever, the Christian Church, is the second largest land owner after the government of India. And this land owning is growing with each year.
And who is to blame? It is Nehru. Because the moment we got independence in 47, he made this whole status quo.
Saint Nehru.
Yeah, you know, he made this whole status quo thing so that now there is no possibility, like exactly like you said, you know, we have made him also a saint. So anything that he has done, any tampering in the constitution that has been done by Nehru and Indira Gandhi is somehow, you know, is accepted today. But if
no, it's beyond scrutiny.
Yeah, it's beyond scrutiny. And today, if, you know, Modi wants to suggest some possible change, because the constitution is not a holy book. So when you want to suggest a change based on the changing society, suddenly people are like, oh, how can you touch the constitution? So I think this whole tying in of the British imperialism with evangelism led to a lot of power in the hands of Christians in India right from the start.
The church in India, because that's wherever it's gone, across Africa it is ravaged, you know, wherever it has set foot and managed to convert at least 50% of the population, the original culture is gone. I mean, this is a fact of history.
And also, one thing that a lot of people would ask is, okay, so they're converting, you know, Hindus or Jains or Muslims or whatever into Christianity. What's wrong with that? What's the big deal? So I think that one of the very good answers to this question was given by Dr. S.L. Bhairappa when he spoke at a seminar on conversions.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Yeah.
You were also a part of it. He said that the problem is that Christianity is a predator religion, and since it grew up in an environment which is to conquer nature, the whole idea is to convert people into their belief, and what happens is then there is a natural intolerance of other faiths. And we have seen so many examples of how pedophilia and child trafficking are epidemics in the Catholic Church. And you know, recently they even made a movie, right? Spotlight.
Spotlight, yeah.
Which was based on the Boston Globe expose.
So, but that's the other thing. The church global apparatus has taken this, it's perfected to an art form. No matter how many thousands of instances of pedophilia gets reported, nothing ever happens to those priests. They, you know, quietly go underground. It's either buried or they go quietly underground, and then things are normal, business as usual.
Yeah,
this is something that no government, no tyrant was able to, even Stalin wasn't able to kind of, you know, reach this level of perfection.
Yeah, because they made conversion into a business, into a game. And vulnerability is a playground. So whenever somebody is vulnerable, now even if you look at the early history of the Missionaries of Charity in Calcutta, when leprosy struck, it was a disease feared by a lot of people, and not too many people were willing to help lepers. So then this was seen as an opportunity by Teresa, and she said, oh, this is a great harvesting ground for the souls.
Absolutely, Hari, absolutely. Go on.
So then she goes there in the guise of trying to help the lepers and give them a home. What she's basically doing is getting them converted. And that's always been the agenda, right? I mean,
that's how it is. Because in one of her so-called confessions, I forget where, she declares that the mission and the sole purpose of her life is to be united with our Lord, the Son of our Lord, Lord Jesus Christ. How does she do it? By harvesting souls, like you said. Each soul that came into her Nirmal Hriday, pure heart, her ashram, her home of whatever, missionaries of charity. Every single person, poor, destitute, dying, sick, was a potential soul to be harvested. You utter the baptism mantra in that guy's ears before he dies, he becomes Christian. Ah, Lord, I've sent you one more soul.
Yeah, and also this is a business model now, especially if you look at the way Christianity's demographics have changed in Europe, and the church-going population has reduced drastically. A lot of people still have some connection to the religious setting. So all they do is a checkbook charity. And where does that money come? Comes to places like India, Africa for conversion activities. And people actually paid money for converting people from Hinduism.
No, it's a great network marketing method, pyramid marketing method. And checkbook charity is a very interesting usage. I must thank you for that. Because here's the thing, and this ties into, the etymological usage you just asked me a while back about why is it called missionaries of charity. According to Christian doctrine, the good Lord, the God provides everything. So if the God always provides everything, why is there even the need for something called a missionaries of charity to exist in the first place? Who even asked? These are fundamental questions, Hari.
Yeah.
So this is what this cult building does to you. It makes you suspend your disbelief. I mean, you willingly suspend your disbelief when reading a work of fiction.
And also another thing is,
this is not fiction. This is a barefaced lie, a fraud, open fraud that you can see every day.
But it has been so well masqueraded by the mainstream media in India. And I think this is also the case in a lot of places in Africa and South America, where the mainstream media is largely Christian. In India, for example, the English media is largely owned by Christian concerns, and therefore they constantly play out this grand narrative of how the church is always helpful, how it always is kind and nice. And similarly, you know, we also see
Bollywood.
Exactly.
Bollywood. You will never see a depiction of a priest who's a pedophile.
Yeah.
The last movie, you know, there was a Malayalam movie, I think. No, sorry, an
Sins.
English movie, Sins.
Yeah.
Who was that disgraced guy now?
The Shiny Ahuja, who was a real life rapist.
Rapist or whatever. So he's shown as a father who has an affair with some
nun.
Hot looking nun. So that movie, I don't think it had a theatrical release. I'm not sure, you can correct me if I'm wrong on that. But then, perhaps that was the last the only movie perhaps. Otherwise, Bollywood depictions of all these priests are, you know, they're elevated a step above God.
Yeah, and you see that especially in Tamil movies. You
know? Yeah.
Tamil movies particularly, they've been painted as such noble people that they can never go wrong. And in fact, the more religious he is shown to be better. Whereas if they show a Hindu Purohita, the more religious he is, the more evil he becomes.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
This is the kind of...
That's a topic we should explore in detail.
Another day.
But then coming back to Mother Teresa and her cult. Somewhere I read, I forget where, I think in Vanity Fair, she is described by Hitchens as the worst human embodiment of the worst of Catholic fundamentalism. Obviously, I'm paraphrasing it because I can't recall it offhand. What is important to also look at in her modus operandi is that there is an element of extreme heartlessness and sadism. There's an anecdote that Hitchens narrates that once Mother Teresa had tried to comfort a screaming sufferer by, you know, this is unbelievable, yeah? This guy is screaming in pain, some cancer, some terminally ill guy. He's screaming in pain and she tells him, "You're suffering. That means Jesus is kissing you." That sufferer screams back, furious, "Then tell your Jesus to stop kissing me."
Yeah, and if people are happy, if people are comfortable, then she will be jobless. If people were not in pain, were not suffering, they will not have anything to do. So therefore, people like Teresa, they thrive in these kind of environments. They thrive in places where people are struggling and where people are vulnerable. Because that is the playing ground for harvesting the soul.
And you're at your weakest psychologically, emotionally,
and you just want somebody to give you a, you know, word of solace. And if that word of solace is Jesus loves you, then
so be it.
You never know, they could go in that direction. In fact, I remember reading, you know, people, how these people abuse their power. There was this guy called Sangliana who was SP. He was a very powerful guy. Whenever people would go to him, apparently when they had trouble, he would say, you know, "Don't worry, we'll help you," and then give them a Bible. So this is what he used to do. So people like this in power, when they forget the fact that they are serving a nation, they are serving a people, and they instead use it as an opportunity to push their own agenda, then where is the honesty in public life?
Forget honesty. That is what these predatory religions do.
And they are expected to do.
That is an extreme hold that they have on your psyche.
And such a person is going to be praised by his parent religion. Such a person is going to be decorated by his parent religion.
Yeah, that's because somewhere along the line, your entire system, be it public discourse, your media, your education, from school all the way up to university, has nearly erased the capacity to think critically, to distinguish what is harmful to you, to your family, to your psyche, to your deepest held convictions in whatever form they are.
Yeah, and now moving towards the kind of reaction around this. So, for example, if the same thing had happened in a different context, all these politicians would be up in arms saying this is, you know, this is ridiculous and they should be sent to jail and they should be shut down. There would be a ban on Missionaries of Charity if it was, God forbid, a Hindu organization. And did you read what Mamata Banerjee has to say about all this?
No.
She said it's a conspiracy of the BJP.
So that is the point, right? She's so far down on the deep end. I seriously doubt, and I'm saying this with utmost respect to Mamata Didi, I seriously suspect her sanity. I think she needs to get checked.
In fact, I suspect that she is still a Hindu.
Forget her politics, forget her pampering of these jihadi elements and church and whoever it is, forget her hatred for BJP. I mean, what you just said, what you quoted her statement is saying, I deeply suspect her sanity. For compassion.
It doesn't make any sense, right? Why would...
Nuns are declaring openly that, you know, they have this buy three, get one free scheme, and she's saying this is a BJP conspiracy. There's something seriously wrong with her
and
sanity.
The people are not even considering what Mother Teresa has to say in her own interviews, in her own private letters.
Perhaps we should read that out, actually. Yeah. Just give me a minute.
There was a famous case, right, when she wrote to a Californian judge. Condone some Keating.
Charles Keating is one of the more infamous or perhaps the largest defrauder of public money in the US in perhaps the mid 80s or early 90s. I can't recall the exact dates. But then he started the Ponzi scheme called the Lincoln Savings and Loans or something like that.
Yeah.
So this man, he like these fly-by-night chit fund operators, he's something similar to that in the US. So this man had his own private jets. He lived a very lavish lifestyle, obviously by stealing other people's money under dubious schemes. And then he also lent his private jet to Mother Teresa.
And donated a lot of money.
More than $1 billion in those days. So he was obviously caught, jailed, and then he was facing a pretty much criminal sentence, punishment basically. Then this woman writes an unsolicited and extremely gratuitous letter to the judge asking, you know, him whether he was a true Christian and whether he
in
had
the name of Jesus Christ.
In the name of Jesus Christ, yes. Please forgive this man. You know, he has a great heart, he's worked, donated so much towards the service of Allah, blah, blah, blah. So the deputy district attorney for Los Angeles, who was also the co-prosecutor of Charles Keating, this guy's name is Paul Turley. And I'll just read out his reply to Mother Teresa's letter. Mother Teresa, you urge Judge Ito to look into the heart as he sentences Charles Keating and do what Jesus would do. I submit the same challenge to you. Ask yourself what Jesus would do if he were given the fruits of a crime. What Jesus would do if he were in possession of money that had been stolen. What Jesus would do if he were being exploited by a thief to ease his conscience. You have been given money by Mr. Keating that he has been convicted of stealing by fraud. Do not permit him the indulgence he desires. Obviously, Mother Teresa, even after his Keating was sentenced, never bothered to reply.
And never bothered to return the money.
No, absolutely.
So, the whole idea is that they're basically trying to fundraise to convert. And, you know, there's a famous interview where they say somebody asked her about the way in which she dealt with Christian patients and non-Christian patients.
Right. So, I think this was on a larger context and not limited to just Christian and non-Christian parents. This was in an interview in 1983 published in India Today. So, the interviewer asks, As a Christian missionary, do you adopt a position of neutrality between Christian poor and other poor? Mother Teresa, I am not neutral. I have my faith. That means Christianity.
Yeah, so clearly she is saying that all poor people are equal, but some poor people are more equal than other poor people.
Because they are Christians, or they are going to be Christians.
Yes.
Right. Interviewer, can the church do any wrong? Teresa, no. As long as it stands on the side of God.
What does that even mean? What does that even mean?
Which God is the question that you have to ask.
No, even if it is their God, somebody can always take a line from the Bible and say, you know, this is what it is. So therefore, it is basically saying the church can do anything it wants as long as it has enough evidence to connect it to some, you know, line from the Bible.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Interviewer, mother, if you were born in the Middle Ages and you were asked at the time of Galileo's Inquisition to take sides, which would you have chosen? The church or modern astronomy? Teresa smiling, the church. This is a lady who, I mean, it can't get more open than this.
And I think, you know, if we just take
and one of the icons, the pictures that used to adorn the pamphlets and the posters of this failed politician Chiranjeevi at Prajarajya Party was Mother Teresa.
Yeah, it's,
I mean, this is a con job of, you know, I don't know,
you know, Himalayan proportion.
Himalayan proportion.
And also, if you look at the way this, you know, pans out in the larger context, and when going back to what Dr. Bhairappa says, what are the dangers if you convert? Is that you are going to fight against abortion? You're going to fight against all the things that come from modern science. There's going to be a constant struggle between your, you know, 2000-year-old philosophy and ideas and modern science. There's going to be a fight between science and ethics, between science and religion.
You're going to go back to dark ages. That Europe was there for 1,000 years.
Yeah,
as simple as that.
And on the other hand, you have enlightened systems like Hinduism and Buddhism and Jainism and all this, where there is openness to question, where there is no constant battle between science and ethics. No Hindu in India will disagree with, you know, evolution or the heliocentric theory.
Hari, you can abuse your own deities, man.
Yeah, you have so
it
much.
It doesn't get better than that.
Yeah, you have so much of freedom. And what is the common understanding in India? Sarva dharma samabhava. Can there be anything more disillusioned than this?
That dubious, man. This is dubious.
Yeah, and I mean, who are you trying to fool by saying everything is the same? There is a huge difference in, you know, the whole Semitic way of thinking and the Eastern way of thinking, which is far more open and accommodative, which is why people are at peace with each other.
Absolutely. So, on the thing of greater religions that grew up in desert, there's also this notion, this comparison of desert religions versus forest religions, because jungle forest religions, because when you grow up in close proximity to nature, you automatically derive ways, a human system evolution, the mind and your impulses. When you are in tune with nature, you also find ways to live in harmony with nature.
Absolutely.
You won't look at nature as an enemy to be fought constantly and to be overpowered, to be exploited.
Absolutely.
This is a key difference.
And when you are looking at this larger thread running through these Semitic faiths and the kind of horrific results like this, you know, child trafficking and pedophilia.
No, and the larger point is, sorry to interrupt you here, you mentioned child trafficking and, you know, selling of infants, poor infants. It's as if their souls are so barren that they don't look at this thing, they don't think twice before doing this. Yeah, it breaks your heart when you just read this.
Yeah, absolutely. And not only are they doing such activities, they're also projecting themselves as saviors.
Absolutely. You see, the Christian doctrine itself says the devil speaks in folk tongues.
Yeah.
And once you have this halo of piety, it's almost that you have to kind of, you're beyond question.
Yeah, and also, you know, like you were mentioning the other day, this blue and white sari has been copyrighted. So you
exactly.
Can't.
Why does a charitable institution need a copyright for something as as stupid and as commonplace as a pattern or multicolored sari?
Because of branding.
There you go.
You can't copy Pepsi logo. You can't copy blue and white sari. So therefore, there is no doubt that this is a very well thought out business enterprise.
Totally. It's a criminal enterprise. If you, I don't know. It is a criminal enterprise. I mean, there's no, why do you want to, you know, mince words when you have to say the truth, right?
Yeah. And then why is this not considered as a criminal enterprise? Because there is
because
a Christian
law.
Yes, but there's also a Christian vote bank in India. You don't want to mess that vote bank, so you don't say anything. Everybody is trying to vie for this because there is a clear bunch of these vote banks in India, and nobody, no political party want to, you know, affect any of these vote banks.
And this vote bank continues to grow by, I mean, this is such a beautiful scheme. On the one hand, you don't want to piss off this vote bank. On the other, after every 5 years, when election comes, you notice that thanks to conversion, this vote bank keeps growing. It keeps growing larger.
Exactly. So then, as this grows larger, then no longer are they vote bank, they become the majority. And then, for example, you see in Kerala, the kind of cover-up that happens is far more than other places. It is very difficult to do an expose in Kerala because every third guy is probably a Christian. Or every second guy, I don't know.
Oh man, you should actually, one of my friends who's a Malayali, from, he has deep roots in Kerala. He says that these guys, these followers of peaceful religions, they have they have divided, cut up Kerala into two neat halves. With Trishur as the midpoint. North of Trishur is all the followers of the religion of peace. South of Trishur is all the followers of religion of love. It is evident, it's visible, man.
So this is very interesting.
Travel to that, it's a small state. I mean, you can cover it, all of Kerala if you do a road trip of about a week or 10 days.
Yeah.
It's and there, it's right in front of your face.
It's very interesting. Kerala, since you brought it up, you know, when you look at the history of Christian-Muslim encounters for so many thousands of years, they've always been fighting and crusades and, you know, at each other's throats. Suddenly in Kerala, it's all peace and love and...
Not anymore.
But that's because now...
Not anymore, because the Christian girls are getting love jihaded.
Ah, well, then the problem is going to start.
There you
but
go.
even then, comparatively, you see that there is a lot more bonhomie between these two faiths in Kerala because it's a Hindu-majority country.
No, they have to keep out the common enemy.
Yeah.
Or the common target group.
So I think, I mean, and also if you see in the doctrine of Islam, right, first is the kafirs, then come the people of the book, and then come, you know, other people like Shias and Ahmadiyyas. So it's a hierarchy.
And then they'll start eating themselves. That's
yeah, so that's the hierarchy. So,
right. So there's this interesting thing that I was looking at. The Mother Teresa myth requires the Indians to play the role of hapless victims. What do you think of Mother Teresa and of the image she gives of India?
This is asked to Hitchens.
This is asked to Christopher Hitchens. Hitchens replies, I've got an enormous pile of coverage from India where my book was published and the reviews seem to be overwhelmingly favorable. There are many Indians who object to the image of their society and its people that is projected. From Mother Teresa and from her fans, you would receive the impression that in Calcutta, there is nothing but torpor, squalor and misery, and people barely have the energy to brush the flies from their eyes. Really and truly, that is a slander on a fantastically interesting, brave, highly evolved and cultured city which has universities, film schools, theatres, bookshops, literary cafes. People do not tug at your sleeve and beg. They are proud of the fact that they don't. So, what does this tell you about how Mother Teresa built her cult and her global enterprise?
And what is so ironic when you say this statement of Hitchens, and I kind of go back to some of my discussions when I was in Calcutta, and there are people in Calcutta
oh, yeah, that,
who I've spoken to
yeah, yeah. Yeah, I wanted to ask you this because you lived there for a while.
I've traveled there many times, and then I spoke to a lot of people, and it's amazing how there is such a high degree of respect for Mother Teresa in Calcutta by Calcuttans, because they have no clue what is happening. They have never visited a Nirmal Hriday. They've been sitting in their homes and reading, you know, whatever newspaper says. And maybe because Jyoti Bosu said something about, you know, Mother Teresa as being a great person, a lot of people just say, oh, she is a pride of Calcutta. So that's the irony, right? I mean, she's basically painting your city in the darkest colors possible.
And you are glorifying her for that.
And you are saying that one of the great things in Calcutta is Missionaries of Charity. So that's the irony, and that shows the ignorance of some of the people. And of course, there are people in Calcutta who know the problems who speak about it. But I'm talking about the common people who, you know, you just go on the street and you're drinking a tea and you're talking to somebody. This is the kind of impression that she has made. And that is also, again, like we were discussing earlier, the media machinations that have made a sinner into a saint.
No, what is also, what I also missed in my discussion about the actual state of Missionaries of Charity, what goes on inside those walls is that needles are not still sterilized, and people who are almost on the deathbed, you know, cancer patients are given painkillers like aspirin. They are not taken to proper hospitals, which are just like you put that person in a cab and 10 minutes away there's a nice hospital which provides great care.
You know, when
what
you,
charity is this? What humane service is this?
You know, when you say all these things, somehow I'm, you know, having a picture of a concentration camp in my head.
Yeah, it is a pious concentration camp.
Yeah, so in some sense, you look at, again, going back to how the media is creating such a narrative. On one side, the moment you say Hitler, you are such a dark and gory image comes. And the moment you say Mother Teresa, all peace and love.
Blue and white sari.
But deep down, there seems to be very, very less difference between these two people.
No, there isn't, because go and look up something called as a Hitler's Pope. That's perhaps a separate topic that we can have another day. You will get some extremely interesting insights. But let's leave it at that. Let's not spoil the suspense. But apart from her whatever so-called seva,
mm-hmm,
her hospitalization services and caring for the sick and dying, this lady, this pious saint, Mother Teresa, in the wake of the Bhopal gas tragedy, she has the gall to give a public statement to the victims of the dead people because of the Union Carbide tragedy. She has the gall to tell the survivors, the surviving family and friends and well-wishers of the victims, that forgive, everything will be all right. Forgive whom? Union Carbide. And who helped Warren Anderson to escape? Rajiv Gandhi's government. Don't forget that Arjun Singh was the chief minister of Madhya Pradesh.
Yeah, and so it's, in some sense, again, you see a close connection between the Congress regime, especially, you know, I think post Indira Gandhi, with Rajiv Gandhi and the, you know, Italian connection and everything, I think like Nehru had the communists and Indira Gandhi continued to cultivate them. With the ascent of Rajiv Gandhi, slowly there seemed to be a move from the communists to the Christian forces.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's true, historically accurate, but look at in this thing, what I could derive is that it seems that India has become like a kind of a playground for anyone to come here from anywhere and do whatever.
Yeah, that's again because the awareness is so low, and it has been carefully cultivated and presented in such a way that all these oppressors are in fact people who are come to protect and save and you know, to do dhara. Like we say, you know, they have come to save you.
Salvation, man. Salvation. Save your damn soul.
Yeah, they are going to take
mine
you
as well.
On a, you know, whatever the equivalent of a Pushpaka Vimana to the paradise.
Right. So I suppose we have covered most of the ground out here, and maybe we'll do a repeat podcast if new news from the hell called Hell's Abode, called Missionaries of Charity, Nirmal Hriday, which we have from whichever branch such unfortunate news will come again. I'm sure it will.
Because it has been coming.
It has been coming.
It has been very consistent.
Fact that it has been gone on, you're not a thief until you get caught. So they've gotten caught this time. Perhaps they'll lie low again, and then they'll restart this same nonsense.
And what I think this all means to us, citizens of India and people who want to look at the future of our country to be bright, and we want to go in a path which leads us to peace and where all the people are happy. Now, a lot of the victims here are Christians themselves.
Absolutely, true.
Therefore, it's important for people to become aware of these kinds of Ponzi schemes in some sense, and call them out, call out the bluff, and not to pander to this pseudo philosophy of Sarva Dharma Samabhava, which is very dangerous and self-destructive.
Also known as secularism in India.
The Indian brand of secularism, which is very dangerous, not just for Hindus, obviously dangerous for Hindus, but also for Muslims, Christians, everybody. Because it basically means that you're using a pseudo-ideology to oppress people irrespective of...
To divide the society, everybody wants a piece of the pie called India.
Yeah.
So I guess we can kind of stop there. For those who want to, have a more comprehensive information about the cult of Mother Teresa, I would kindly urge you to read, obviously, The Missionary Position, Mother Teresa in Theory and Practice by Christopher Hitchens, Mother Teresa, The Final Verdict by Dr. Arup Chatterjee, Mother Teresa, Come Be My Light, The Private Writings of the Saint of Calcutta. And you can obviously Google for the criticism and documentation on the activities and life of Mother Teresa. There's enough and more well-researched and authentic information about this fake saint who Arup Chatterjee calls as the Ghoul of Calcutta, and whom Hitchens calls as Hell's Angel. So that in effect brings us to the end of this episode. We do this every week. We feature important events like this and give an in-depth commentary and have a lively discussion. It's been my pleasure. Hari Ravi Kumar. This is Sandeep Balakrishna signing off.
Hari Ravi Kumar.